Thanks. So first of all, I would like to start by thanking the organizers for giving me the opportunity to present these results. So I'm going to speak about KPZ scaling in non-integrable and integrable classical models in one dimension. And also I'm going to show some other exponents other than KPZ. So this is a work done in collaboration with Abhijit Das here, who played one of the central role in the spin chain calculations. Abhishek Dhar, colleague at ICTS, Herbert Spohn, Christian Mendel, Kedar Damle, David Hughes, and Austin Lamacraft. And I'm going to present some results which are here and also sort of share some preliminary results and sort of some expected results. The contents are as follows. After some background and motivation, I will directly jump to a nonlinear Schrodinger equation on a lattice. So this is a discrete nonlinear Schrodinger equation, basically a discretization of the Gross-Peters-Key equation, which breaks integrability. Then I'm going to discuss some very preliminary expectations on vector DNLS and some other aspects of DNLS. I'm then going to talk about classical x-axis spin chain, which I call Lattice-Landau-Lifshitz model, LLL, which is non-integrable. After which I'm going to talk about integrable Lattice-Landau-Lifshitz model, ILLL, which is a classical integrable lattice model. And then I'm going to say a few words about quantum classical analogy. So basically, essentially low dimensional systems are sort of full of surprises. You have things like violation of Fourier law, anomalous behavior in spatiotemporal correlations, autocorrelations, anomalous domain wall evolution, and sort of low dimensional classical systems also have deep connections to KPZ class. So these are basically some of the motivations. And also, it's our hope that these kind of systems can be used as potential systems to realize KPZ physics. So basically, just a brief overview of KPZ's equation, which has nonlinearity, relaxation, and noise. And the derivative of KPZ equation is essentially the Noisy-Burgers equation, which is sort of slightly more relevant for our case here. And typically, this is just an experimental overview. And typically, what they sort of measure in experiments is this width function, which is basically extracted from height h of x, t data. And what is essentially expected from KPZ is these kind of exponents of alpha is equal to half. This width function goes as this expression here. And for large enough length, it becomes independent of length, and then beta becomes 1/3. And so these are the kind of exponents that they look for in experiments, basically once they have their height data. So just a brief background of experiments. So starting from growing interface of bacterial colonies, where they sort of reported alpha is equal to half and beta 0.3. There's also experiments on paper combustion, where they sort of reported close to KPZ exponents. The coffee ring experiment, where you have deposition of coffee particles at the edge, which forms the coffee ring. And basically, the growth of this deposition is also in this nice paper. There's a KPZ regime and chemical reaction in disordered medium and so on. So there's also interface growth due to division of cancer cells, and which also report KPZ systems. So in addition to these alpha beta exponents, there's also been very interesting results on going beyond just universal scaling in terms of getting fluctuations. And in these nice experiments, they sort of found in a growing liquid crystal interface that there's a trace medium distribution depending on where, depending on details of the initial condition. And a few weeks ago, there's an experimental paper where they sort of can start with any curved initial condition. So not only KPZ exponents, but also this kind of trace medium distribution has been seen in experiments. Interestingly, as we saw in this program and basically a lot of talks, spatiotemporal correlation is sort of very interesting, and this is what many of us compute. And I mean, technically, it's interesting that there's still no experimental data for spatiotemporal correlation yet. But point is that we know, we sort of know what to expect in terms of KPZ equation. So the broad motivation is that if the systems that I'm going to explain, which is the discrete nonlinear Schrödinger equation and x-axis spin chain, if they have KPZ exponents, they're potential experimental candidates. So although there has been experiments on KPZ systems, I have just reported situations where they get KPZ exponents, but there's a lot of uncertainty and to be honest, the number of experiments which actually see KPZ are not too many. So it'll be good to have a system like the DNLS, which has been realized very well experimentally as a potential candidate for KPZ physics. So so that is one of the motivation. And also to, since we have studied this in great detail, it will be interesting to capture distributions and make some connections to random matrices. So so basically, this, I think, has been mentioned again and again in this conference. Basically, we are looking for some spatio-temporal correlations, connected piece such as this, and C of x comma t or Fourier transform S of k omega, which is sort of called the finite temperature dynamical structure factor. And there are several works, there are several works on such correlation functions, and I'm going to focus on these two, as far as non-integrable system is concerned, DNLS and classical XXZ, and this system as far as integrable chain is concerned. So basically, let me just give some very earlier work here. So essentially, this is the discrete nonlinear Schrödinger equation. This is the equations of motion. And suppose you solve this and you basically get S of k omega. So this is basically the goal, and I'm going to say more details about this. I also wanted to mention that S of k omega is sort of experimentally feasible in cold atoms. So there is this, on one hand, DNLS is realized, and there is this technology for measuring these things. So that is why many a times we compute S of k omega instead of C of x comma t. So basically, this is some earlier work with Austin Lamacraft, where we sort of started with some initial conditions which we chose to be nearly thermal. And the details did not seem to be too much dependent on initial conditions because the system is fairly chaotic. So, and we basically found some results which I'm going to present here. And also, one, if you can do simulations using the true e to the minus beta EH, and basically you get the, basically it is independent of initial conditions. So question is what to expect. So interestingly, when we did this and reported this, our paper was on archive on 30th Jan 2012, and we sort of had no nonlinear fluctuating hydrodynamics at that time. So basically we sort of didn't have any detailed predictions from NFH, but on the other hand, we knew that for low dimensional systems, one should expect anomalous exponents. So so actually the first NFH paper appeared of Herbert Spohn appeared on May 28th, and so basically there was some sort of a gap in trying to understand more details of what we see. But basically what we saw at that time was this S of k omega. As you see, these are nice peaks here, which are sort of scaling as KPZ, and we saw evidence of KPZ. So then the question was, do we also get the scaling form? And at that time, we sort of tried to understand this in terms of nonlinear fluctuating hydrodynamics and sort of developed a slightly better understanding of this. At the time we wrote this paper, there was no sort of detailed understanding of nonlinear fluctuating hydrodynamics. So the way we understood was, we understood this system as two Burgers equation, where one sector acts as a noise and dissipation to the other sector. So we sort of had a heuristic understanding, but then later it became a little more concrete, and we sort of tried to bring in this NFH into this DNLS thing. So I'm going to briefly describe how to adapt NFH formalism to discrete nonlinear Schrödinger equation. Any questions? Okay. So I think most of this has been sort of discussed in this program. So the general idea is that is outlined here. Essentially, you have some microscopic Hamiltonian, local conserved charges and currents. Then you do appropriate ensemble and do averaging. Then you write some continuity Euler equation. Then you expand to some second order. And then you basically go to appropriate normal modes, which often gives you coupled partial differential equations. And in it is hidden KPZ physics and Levy physics. So that is the general idea. So let me go over quickly. So basically, if you sort of implement this kind of thing here, you can show that at very high temperature, so this is a very important point, that the discrete nonlinear Schrödinger equation that is written here has only two conserved quantities, density and energy. So at very high temperature, it has only two conserved quantities. And at very low temperature, there's a third quantity that is almost conserved, which is the phase difference. So that is really crucial, and that makes DNLS and XXZ spin chain apart from the other models, where you basically have three conserved quantities. So here you have temperature, which is a nice parameter where you can go have both diffusive and KPZ and so on. Yeah. So it goes as information in the initial conditions. So basically you start do Monte Carlo for some high temperature. Then you basically, you have your initial conditions and then you run your dynamics. You will see that only density and energy is conserved. So, but when you do extremely low temperature, very low temperature, then you see that there's a phase difference, which also is conserved. And then basically, almost conserved. So I'll just explain that, yeah. Reflection above, sorry? I mean, essentially there are, I mean, you can basically just show that these two are conserved. There is, Yes, for this discrete nonlinear Schrödinger equation, yes. Because this is non-integrable, Yeah, so, right. So as of now, so basically, so now I'm going to so when you have high temperature, you basically get diffusive. But when you go for low temperatures, there is this additional conserved quantity that I wanted to show, and basically then it sort of falls into the nonlinear fluctuating hydrodynamics thing, where you basically have three conserved quantities, and you can use that machinery to essentially write down linear fluctuating hydrodynamic theory, and these are sort of the sound speeds. And then you can essentially go to the next order, and then go to normal modes, and then you can basically write this nonlinear fluctuating hydrodynamic theory. So just going back here, these are the speed of sounds. So you see minus C, zero, and plus C. So what you have is one left mover, one right mover, and one thing at the center. Right, so those are the sound speeds. And these are basically the nonlinear terms here. So everything is sort of encoded in the G matrix. So once you know the structure of the G matrix, you can sort of try to guess which university class it is going to fall under. So let me give example of only DNLS here. So in the DNLS, this is the G matrices. And after some practice, you can see, it's easy to see that the left movers couple nonlinearly with themselves and to the right mover, because there's a term here and here. And the heat mode couples nonlinearly to the left mover and the right mover. So this is not the KPZ equation, but the point is that the leading nonlinearity is the most important thing, and that is what gives the KPZ physics. So phi alpha here are the normal modes. So phi plus phi minus go as KPZ, and phi naught is the heat mode, and it shows it has Lewis scaling. Okay, so and depending on more interesting scenarios of the G matrix, you can have other possibilities. So since I have to go to spin chains, so basically this is sort of more or less explains why you get KPZ scaling and a little more details of that can be understood from NFH. So because of this additional conserved quantity, also certain other things are interesting, which I just want to make a small detour, where because of this emerging conserved quantity, you can also calculate Otox and Lyapunov exponents and so on, and ask what these emerging quantities, conserved quantities at low temperature, how do they change the OTOC and so on. But this is sort of a side remark, but the main message was to show the KPZ scaling in the discrete nonlinear Schrödinger equation, which is a non-integrable classical equation in one dimension. Yeah. Yes, so that's a very good question. So if you sort of, even if you wait extremely long enough, eventually you might lose, because these facelifts start getting activated. And even harder question would be if one can see this crossover from KPZ to diffusive. And somehow we did not succeed. So if you choose some low temperature, we see KPZ for very long times and it's KPZ. If you change the temperature a bit, then it becomes diffusive. And we sort of understand for spin chains. I will just go to spin chains and I'll, yeah. Okay, so let me skip this multi-component because I want to spend time on spin chains, but I can discuss this later. But the idea of multi-component NLS is that if you have more coupled nonlinear Schrödinger equations and then you discretize them, which are all experimentally very relevant, the possibility is that you can probably have more richer G matrices effectively, and because you have multiple fields here, and we sort of can make some approximate predictions here, but let me not go here. I can discuss during the question time, but let me go to the classical XXZ spin chain now. So it turns out that classical XXZ spin chain has a similar story, but of course there are some subtle differences. But this is the Hamiltonian, and basically this is the equation of motion. You can again parameterize it in this convenient form, and then you will see that you can write these equations of motion, and then you will basically see that XXZ also has two conserved quantities, SZ and energy. But then there is this phase difference, which is a parameter here, that starts getting conserved at low temperatures, and we'll show you plots of that. So the story is similar, but there are differences, and I can discuss the differences maybe later. But there's lot of things that one can learn from DNLS. Okay, so these are the results for high temperature for the XXZ spin chain, which is non-integrable spin chain on a lattice, non-integrable spin chain. Yeah. So this is basically diffusive. So this is SZ correlator, and this is energy correlator. So just to elaborate on Benjamin's question, so if you basically have low temperature regime, then you can show that the number of facelifts basically goes as exponentially grows with temperature. So this is so that is why it's sort of very difficult to see this crossover, because little bit here and there you this thing, but it's clearly an exponential behavior which we see very nicely. So now once you're in the low temperature regime, you have three conserved quantities under which again falls into nonlinear fluctuating hydrodynamics. And one can do the same theory, but and make some predictions and so on. And these are the experimental results. So let us, so because three things are conserved now, the phase difference, SZ, and energy, this is just a matrix of the figure with all the correlations, okay? But let me just focus on one piece here. This is SZ correlator. This is spin correlator. As you see that there are these two sound modes we see, and this is getting broader and broader. And basically, once we scale it and appropriately go to normal modes, we see KPZ physics here. This is the energy correlator, and you see a central heat mode here. So because these are the original variables, once you go to normal modes, it's more clear, and one can see that this is phi minus correlator, which is basically which shows KPZ behavior. And this is the phi zero correlator, which shows the Levy scaling. So this is what we see. So basically, what I'm trying to say is that if you have dt phi minus, then essentially, given my G matrix, I can have many terms here, but I definitely have a phi minus square here. So even if I have something like phi plus, phi minus, or something, some other terms, the leading behavior is KPZ. So, and for phi naught, it turns out that on the right-hand side, you have phi plus square and phi minus square. So there's nonlinearity coming from the other, this thing, which gives you this heat mode. Okay, so this is a table that we have for the non-integrable lattice Landau Lifshitz equation. So it is entirely different from the quantum case, as you see here, which I will show. So at easy plane at high temperature, both spin and energy are diffusive. At easy plane at low temperature and zero magnetic field, we have diffusive sound modes and Levy 3/2 heat mode. This is the one which I showed you the most. Easy plane and low temperature and small magnetic field, we have KPZ sound modes and Levy heat mode. And easy axis at high temperature, we have diffusive spin and energy peaks. So, but again, these are sort of still not very. It could be much better. So we can go. We need to go to longer systems and longer times. But this is basically the status of the classical X-axis spin chain. So now let me go to. ILL model, integrable lattice Landau Lifshitz model. So here basically, classical chaotic models have just few conserved quantities, and a few conserved quantities were needed for NFH, which subsequently explained KPZ and Levy behavior. So what if you have huge number of conserved quantities in classical integrable models? So, and this falls outside the paradigm of NFH and naively we would not expect KPZ. So this is the model. This model is H is a function here, and basically the function is given here, and it has three regimes. So it is an integrable model of classical spins on a lattice. And so the advantage is you can do long system sizes here because it is classical system, and it has three regimes: easy plane, easy axis, and isotropic. In the isotropic limit, it becomes this model, which is still integrable and which is classical. So here basically what we saw is the following. This is the result for the isotropic case. So here we saw the spin-spin correlator is basically KPZ. So not only is the exponent 2/3, x over 2/3 here, but also the scaling form is definitely more KPZ as we show here. So this is the KPZ scaling form and this is our data. So the scaling form is KPZ. So after that, a very nice paper appeared here where there's a discrete time and discrete space classical model, which is integrable, which also see KPZ behavior in an integrable model. And the continuum limit of this actually goes to the isotropic model that I showed in the previous slide. So this is basically the SZSZ correlator. So this is KPZ presumably for an entirely different reason. So it has nothing to do with all these arguments that I wrote here. This is the energy-energy correlation, and it is always it is ballistic here. An energy-energy correlation turns out to be ballistic always. So now let's go to easy plane. So in easy plane case, spin is ballistic and energy is also ballistic. As you can see here, x over t scaling, which is ballistic. In the easy axis, spin is diffusive and energy is ballistic. So this is one of the examples where you have integrable model, but you still have some diffusive scaling. and it's a classical model here. And then if you put all these things into a table, okay, so one more thing is you can also do domain wall dynamics, and you can see that the domain wall evolution of SZ also has KPZ scaling in the isotropic limit. So the KPZ scaling is only in the isotropic limit. And if you make a table summarizing all of them, you can say show that easy plane, this is the table, basically. And the numerical data is very convincing in this case, and we have this table. So now it turns out that if you take this table and compare it with the quantum XXZ spin chain, okay, the quantum XXZ spin chain, they both share the same table. So both quantum XXZ chain, these are some papers, and the classical ILL chain have the same table. There is no theory really available yet for the classical case, and I think Veer Bulchandani will sort of say some things about it. And this sort of says that the correct classical limit of quantum XXZ could be this ILL model. But this is just philosophical. So basically, they share the same table in every regime. So that is the more important thing. Since I have few minutes, let me just go back to I went faster than I thought. So let me just go back to multi-component NLS because this is something interesting, but we have not done much. But the point is that. So this is the multi-component Gross-Pitevsky equation, as many of you would recognize. There are two fields psi, and there's a coupling between the two fields. So you can discretize this model and get a two-component, for example, in this case it's two-component, you can get a two-component discretized DNLS. Now the question is, because it is two-component, you can have bigger G matrices. So also it has been well known that if depending on various structure of these G matrices, you can get all sorts of interesting exponents, not just KPZ. So these are some papers where they report interesting exponents for case of coupled fields and multiple fields and so on. So it would be interesting to see if something can be done here where you can, and there are a lot of parameters to play here. So hope is that some matrices, some elements of the G matrix can be put to zero, and you can just go away from KPZ and maybe get something else and so on. But let me just naively, what would happen is the following. This is the Hamiltonian written in some other variables, rho and v variables. And very naively, what would happen is that if you have symmetry in the problem, and if you define charge as 1 plus 2 and spin as 1 minus 2, because of symmetry, the charge has to couple to charge square. Charge can couple to charge square, but spin cannot couple to spin square. So because of symmetry, you sort of the spin mode might even become diffusive, but the charge mode might be KPZ. So one can make very interesting predictions, but these needs to be checked, and one needs to employ rigorously nonlinear fluctuating hydrodynamics for this multi-component system, and then actually verify these things. So in the broken symmetry case, both modes will become KPZ, and in this case, you'll have like two sounds to the right, two sounds to the left, one heat mode, and so on and so forth. So it's a more complicated situation. But basically, hopefully, one can realize more exponents in this kind of physically realistic system. OK, so I have a lot of time for questions. That is good. So let me just conclude by saying that the discrete NLS and XXZ fall into KPZ class, and moreover might have interesting crossovers which no one has seen in terms of temperature, time, and so on and so forth. It is different from the other low-dimensional classical models which have KPZ in the sense that this new conserved quantity is emergent at low temperatures. And surprising KPZ physics is found in classical integral model, presumably for entirely different reasons. And the connection between classical ILL and quantum XXZ is sort of interesting. And as outlook, vector NLS in one dimension can be useful to generalize NFH for multi-component case. And because of the pseudo-conserved quantities, you can have interesting scenarios for OTOC, Lyapunov exponents, for DNLS, and also for classical XXZ, that is probably going to be the same story. So there's one thing that I want to mention, that this kind of model is sort of not yet addressed to the best of my knowledge, where you have power law models with all-to-all coupling in one dimension. And we recently showed that in this paper that the large N field theory for k greater than 1 is a local field theory. So the energy functional becomes local. And therefore, one can even try to do NFH for these kind of systems and in k greater than 1 limit. So one interesting question for the discrete nonlinear Schrödinger equation is the Ablowitz-Lardik case. So the discretized version that I have on my right-hand side is this in my nonlinear Schrödinger equation, in my DNLS. But instead of this discretization, if I have this, I have this kind of discretization, both give the same continuum limit, but this model is integrable. This is integrable. This is called Ablowitz-Lardik discretized model. And one can also approach integrability by doing this, or you can go to integrability by going to continuum. And it's not very clear what is happening here, but although there are studies where it is going to become from KPZ to ballistic. But still, I think a lot of things remain to be done. And then what about Tracy Widom distributions, both in non-integrable and integrable case? Because now we have a classical integrable model which has KPZ. Question is, can you get Tracy Widom distributions? And something I forgot to mention here is that generally it will be good to have a general hydrodynamics for the classical spin chain, something like what Herbert did for TODA, because it turns out that the Lax matrices are known for this classical spin chain, and hopefully that will give some intuition of why we get KPZ. So the although TODA and Ablowitz-Lardik are integrable, they don't give any KPZ. They just give ballistic behavior. On the other hand, these classical integrable models are classical integrable, but still give KPZ. So that is something interesting to do. Thank you. Thank you for your attention.
So, well, I have essentially two remarks. The last question, one of the last question about the generalized hydrodynamics for the classical Landau-Lischitz. So with my colleague Gamma Yun, we already formulated this hydrodynamics, and I already gave a couple of talks about this. It's unfortunately not published, but it's been worked out. So I can tell you more if you're interested.
That's the continuum, right? In the continuum, you show in the continuum it's integrable, and you talk about the continuum system, right?
It doesn't matter. So you can put it on a lattice. The formalism is the same. So, yeah, it doesn't, it's not that important. And then another remark about the question that you posed also toward the end, whether the integrable lattice Landau-Lischitz is the semi-classical limit of the XZ spin chain. The answer is yes. So this has been worked out as well. So this how you retrieve this semi-classical description of the integrable quantum lattice models.
Are you saying the thing that is worked out is from a large spin quantum model to the classical case, or
right? So you can start from the spin chain, which is integrable,
but with large spin, right?
With large spin.
With large spin, yeah. So I just wanted to make this comment that there is a model where a large spin model is integrable. And then if you take the classical limit of that, you'll get the isotropic version of this classical integrable model. But I'm not sure if you will get all the other regimes. So it's not very clear. I know that there's a limit where you can get the isotropic log 1 plus SI dot this thing. So I'm not sure if you get the entire.
Let's discuss afterwards.
Yeah, OK.
Another question? So did I understand it correctly that for the integrable case, the So the reason for emergence of KPZ is not fully clear, and the what class of models show is also not fully clear. So how to?
So what probably is happening is the following. So on one hand, you have TODA and Oblowitz-Ladik, which don't show KPZ. On the other hand, you have this integrable spin chains, which shows KPZ. What is different in these two seems that there is some non-abelian symmetry in these spin chains. So it looks like, and even the one that Thomas Prosen, the paper that they wrote, there is the same symmetry. So it looks like you need some non-abelian symmetry, and maybe that would differentiate. But this is all, again, not fully clear. At least if there's anyone else in the audience who can say more, that's... Yeah, that's for the quantum. I mean, from the quantum, you can sort of, yeah, but without thinking about the quantum, if we can just, in terms of classical model, you have TODA and Oblowitz-Ladik on one hand, and your spin chains on the other, can you say something? From quantum, yeah, you can probably say that you need some non-abelian symmetry. Sure. Yes, we tried, and I don't know whether the data was very clear. So Avijit did that, and do you see diffusive or with field, the integrable model with the magnetic field? So what do you? Yeah. So I. Yeah. The question is with the field, it's ballistic. Yeah. Sorry.
Another question? Okay, thanks. Thank you very much. Yes.